Providence, Rhode Island. Welcome to the Potterverse. It's a podcast dedicated to the book and film universe of Harry Potter. So grab your favorite wands and time turners. Let's step into the night and pursue that flighty temptress adventure. And welcome. My name is Mary Larson.
My name is Blake, and I love the final few lines of this chapter.
Me too. It's what I was going to read.
It's the what Harry does to his uncle is spectacular. In every way, it's one of those moments you realize that Harry is getting older, and it feels oh so good.
That's right. Older, wiser.
Yeah.
I love it. Well, you know what? How about I just go for it? "What's that?" he snarled, staring at the envelope Harry was still clutching in his hand. "If it's another form for me to sign, you've got another." "It's not," said Harry cheerfully. "It's a letter from my godfather." "Godfather?" spluttered Uncle Vernon.
Spluttered.
"You haven't got a godfather." "Yes, I have," said Harry brightly. "He was my mom and dad's best friend. He's a convicted murderer, but he's broken out of wizard prison and he's on the run. He likes to keep in touch with me, though. Keep up with my news. Check I'm happy." And grinning broadly at the look of horror on Uncle Vernon's face, Harry set off towards the station exit, Hedwig rattling along in front of him for what looked like a much better summer than last.
That's good stuff. The growth that Harry has from the beginning of this book, where he's asking his Uncle Vernon for a permission slip. And even though he does turn his aunt into a big balloon and she flies off into the distance, he was reluctant in doing so. It was more of a mistake. It was more of
His second aunt or whatever. Yeah, but whatever. Situation.
It doesn't matter. What I'm saying is it happened.
It's
yes.
Fine if you blow those ones up.
And I'm sure that he was happy that it did happen. But it was still an uncontrollable magic. It was a mistaken magic type deal.
A magic toot, if one may.
Everybody toots.
You're welcome.
That was good. That was good. But in this particular case, at the end of this book, Harry makes a very specific choice. He is threatening Uncle Vernon without threatening so much Uncle Vernon, without saying it, but just more implying it. And that is excellent.
Well done. Well done, Potter. Well done.
Yes.
Before we get into the rest of the show, we would love to take a moment to thank our friends at jointhenerdclan.com. If you've been checking out the Potterverse and we bring you some Lumos in the time of Nox, if we keep you company, if you dig the way that we handle Potter, you can actually let us know that in many ways, but in one of the best ways is by becoming a member at jointhenerdclan.com. If for little as $2 a month, that's less than a cup of coffee, you could probably find that amount of change on the ground if you really wanted to. You can become a member, get access to our free extra podcast. We've got my Bridgerton Bot podcast. Blake is doing Voyager from the Outlander series. You get early access to our podcast, swag, all types of fun things happen at jointhenerdclan.com. So check that out, and we are going to get into the show.
"I solemnly swear that I'm up to no good."
Well, after all of that time turning that happened in the last chapter, Harry and Hermione get back to the hospital wing just in time, and Professor Snape is there. Upstairs, they hear him. Freaking out, man. Saying, "Sirius Black is gone, and I bet Potter had something to do with this." Lupin, of course, has to leave Hogwarts because he's a werewolf, and Snape decided to tell everybody about it. But he gave Harry his invisibility cloak and the Marauder's map back. You're welcome. And then Harry, Ron, and Hermione go back on the Hogwarts Express. Ron gets a new owl. Harry gets a permission slip finally. All ends well. All ends well. Except the Dark Lord is about to return. We're just going to breeze past that. Oh, yeah. Oh, Trelawney just said that.
Whatever, it's fine. Don't worry about it.
Totally fine. Eat some more chocolate.
Here, let me get my brick of chocolate out for you. Oh, you know? You know what stands out to me in this chapter is how sad and how bad I feel for Lupin.
Oh, okay.
Why?
Yep.
What
were, nope.
what,
I just, what were you I just wanted for? To see who you were going to say. Okay, yep, go for it.
Well, why? What do you think I was going to say?
I mean,
Snape?
No. Yeah. Yeah.
I do feel bad.
Me
because
too.
He gets,
me too.
He gets gaslit. You?
So, I don't know what happened to me.
No.
Telling you guys.
Shame.
Prisoner of Azkaban, this go-around,
yeah.
I'm Team Snape.
Wow.
What is happening to me?
There's a couple of things that I think that happens to Snape. First, one, he gets gaslit in a major yeah. way by Dumbledore. And that is unfortunate. That's unfortunate because Snape is supposed to be part of the crew.
Hello? Seriously? Nobody's in the crew. Nobody knows what's going on. But, okay, can we just like take a moment here?
Mm-hmm.
Like, Dumbledore keeps secrets from everybody. From everybody.
Yes.
Like, we're supposed to trust Hagrid, and yet the kids are like, oh, we're going to pretend. Like, why can't the kids tell Hagrid they had a time turner and that they helped save Buckbeak? Isn't Hagrid, like, Dumbledore's most trusted person? What are we doing here?
What are we doing here?
Come on, guys.
Well, you know what? Let me read the part that I kind of understand why.
His circle is like nobody. Dumbledore's circle is himself. That is it. It's on a need-to-know basis. And I think if he was just a better communicator, there would have been a heck of a lot less problems. Don't you?
Well, the way...
Like, he has a communication issue.
He absolutely does have a communication
trust
issue.
Trust issues,
but the
too.
But the way that Snape reacts here, it kind of lends a little justification on why Dumbledore keeps him out of the loop.
He goes, I mean, he's a little, yeah, hot-tempered.
And as we said, Dumbledore gaslights Snape here in a big, big, big way.
Give it to me.
Harry was trying to hear what the voices were saying. They were drawing nearer. He must have disapparated Severus. We should have left somebody in the room with him when this gets out. He didn't disapparate! Snape roared, now very close at hand. You can't apparate or disapparate inside this castle. This has something to do with Potter. And then, like, think of this moment. Think of this moment. Snape, who mm-hmm. has been relatively cool and collected this entire time. Like,
yeah, this entire book, for
this
the most
entire
part.
Book, except when he's dealing with
Sirius.
With Sirius.
Who tried to kill him. Is there a child down here?
I don't think so.
Okay.
I don't think so. No, I don't see any kids.
Okay. All right, good. Our kids often sneak down.
Yes, they do. He has kept his relative cool all book. He does freak out when it does have to do with Sirius, but it's always freaking out towards somebody else. It's always freaking out towards one of the kids or to Lupin or to Sirius himself or whoever. Never at Dumbledore. Never. Severus always keeps his calm, except for this time. Severus, be reasonable. Harry has been locked up. Bam! The door of the hospital wing door burst open. Fudge, Snape, and Dumbledore came striding into the ward. Dumbledore alone looked calm. Indeed, he looked as though he was quite enjoying himself. Fudge appeared angry, but Snape was beside himself. Out with it, Potter, he bellowed. What did you do? Professor Snape, shrieked Madame Pomfrey. Control yourself. See here, Snape, be reasonable, said Fudge. The door's been locked. They helped him escape! I know it! Snape howled, pointing at Harry and Hermione. His face was twisted, spit flying from his mouth. Calm down, man, Fudge barked. You're talking nonsense! You don't know Potter! Shrieked Snape. He did it! I know he did it!
He's right!
That will do, Severus, said Dumbledore quietly. Think about what you are saying. This door has been locked since I left the ward 10 minutes ago. Madam Pomfrey, have these students left their beds? Of course not, said Madam Pomfrey, bristling. I've been with them ever since you left. Well, there you have it, Severus, said Dumbledore calmly. Unless you are suggesting that Harry and Hermione are able to be in two places at once, I'm afraid I don't see any point in troubling them any further. Oh, my goodness. So you get a chance to see why he is gaslighting Snape and keeping him out of the loop. Because Snape's just too close to this.
Listen, he doesn't trust anybody. Because everybody in his circle, for the most part, is going to blab it to somebody. Even if he tells Harry things, Harry's going to tell Ron and Hermione, and you know that Ron cracks under pressure.
Mm-hmm.
Okay,
that's
so I appreciate it. I appreciate that he has to keep everything close, but it just sucks. Because
it does suck.
I really think that they needed some like team building exercises. They needed to have like a leadership development coach be sent to Hogwarts to really help fine tune things a little bit more. Okay, so can we just chill with Snape for a moment?
Absolutely.
Okay, I know we're going to get some flack about this because Snape is not the most liked person on the planet. He does a lot of wrong by Harry. He's a mean and cruel teacher in a lot of the situations. But I got to tell you, having read these books several times and now being married, what's going on there?
I know, sorry.
And now being married to a Slytherin myself and now reading these books with my Slytherin husband. Fully digesting the love that a Snape-like Slytherin would have had for Lily. I feel badly for him because in Snape's mind, let's reaffirm this.
Sure.
He really thinks that Sirius Black wanted to kill him.
Yep.
Okay?
Yep.
Could have had it not been for James Potter. Like, literally attempted murder. Never got in trouble for it. Got away with it.
Good point.
Jerk for life. Oh, and then guess what? He's responsible in Snape and the Wizarding World's minds of being one of the main reasons why Lily and James were killed.
Mm-hmm.
Lily is really the only one he cares about.
Sure.
So he says, this guy wanted to kill me. He's responsible for the love of my life's death. And now he's been trying to come after Harry Potter, who I've been charged with trying to save my entire life. He comes in here hanging out with Werewolf Lupin, who I also don't trust. And they've like confunded Harry Potter. My only job right now is to save this stupid kid. I can't even handle it. He always gets things in trouble. And now he escapes. Someone who I know tried to murder me, who I believe is rightfully convicted of murdering the love of my life, who also has been convicted of murdering several people, who I have not necessarily seen enough evidence about, because he was knocked out when they flip-flopped Peter Pettigrew.
Right.
So he didn't get to see the little switcheroo happen, and now Sirius is gone.
Good point. And you know what? Here's another thing that happens too. Sirius is gone, right? As you just said, everybody thinks still, based on the preponderance of evidence, that Sirius still wants to kill Harry.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. He's freaking out. And of course he's upset.
Yeah. And a sneaky thing happens here.
Sneaky, eh?
A sneaky thing happens.
Tell me.
Dumbledore and Fudge have a conversation about the... It's Mary. If you're listening on the podcast app right now, Mary is messing around with her
microphone. Blake keeps asking me what I want for my birthday. I want a working mic stand.
You know what?
That's not all I want, though.
Fair enough.
That shouldn't come from like my actual birthday gift. Like you can put a bow on it if it works.
You still haven't told me what you want for your birthday.
I'm still deciding.
Okay. Well, you better hurry up, Marvin, because we only got a limited amount of time.
Cinco de Mary is coming.
So a sneaky thing happens in that everybody thinks that Sirius still wants to kill Harry Potter, which is fine. But
not
Dumbledore,
fine.
Well, no, it is fine in that they feel like that Sirius still wants to kill him. Like it's just a matter of fact as opposed to conjecture. Though Dumbledore has a conversation with Fudge. Hey, so hey Cornelius, buddy, what are we doing with these Dementors?
Yeah.
And Fudge is like, oh yeah, we gotta get rid of them. Get rid of them. What are you talking about? We got to get rid of him. Everybody still thinks that Sirius wants to kill Harry. They are the reason why that he was there to begin with.
They failed. They attacked Harry Potter.
Exactly. It's not that everybody thinks that this is all solved and happy-go-lucky. It's the fact that the Dementors attacked Harry Potter. And Fudge knows this and says, yeah, you know what? We're getting him out. We're getting him out. And not only are we going to get him out, we're going to get him out tonight. Tonight they're gone. We're going to pack him right up, send him off to Azkaban. We'll be good. We're all set.
I love how in like 2 books from now, they're like, oh, Harry, no Dementors would attack you. We don't believe you. A Dementor.
And it's
forgetting like 100 Dementors tried to attack him 2 years before.
And nearly succeeded.
Seriously.
If it wasn't for some pretty extraordinary magic that Harry was apparently capable of doing, he'd be dead. D-E-D, dead.
Expecto Patronum.
So, you know, I just find that Fudge is not doing this for the sake of justice, if you will, for the sake of being right
in the newspapers.
He's got to look good,
yeah.
And he's got to save himself. He's got to save his own. He's got to save his own behind, because if he doesn't do this and if he doesn't capitulate to whatever Dumbledore wants, especially as it relates to the Dementors, he's going to have some major political problems on his hand. And Fudge, if not anything else, is at least politically savvy.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
I do.
Another thing that happens here in terms of justice, because as we have discussed, I think ad nauseum on this podcast, that the underlying theme of this book is what is justice? Like how do we administer justice in the wizarding world? What Snape does to Lupin is really unjust. And, you know, just leaking this little mistake or leaking this little information.
I disagree.
Really? I guess,
kills me, guys. Let me
follow up my final thought and then I will let you take the floor. My final thought is that Harry still, even though he has, you know, stopped, you know, the murder of Buckbeak and set free Sirius Black.
Yes.
And all of these things have happened. And, you know, it's a victory, though it is a different kind of victory than what he had experienced in the first two books. The first two books were very A to B to C. Like, I do this, the bad guy dies, and we're all good.
Okay.
This one is A to Z to X to Y to C, you know, like it
to be continued.
It's everywhere. And he still feels a real sense of dread. He still feels a real sense of loss because Lupin himself is now gone and it has upset everybody. That is an excellent ending for a book like this. This ending could not work in the first two books. Because the first two books were, yay, Hogwarts! Whee! Quidditch!
Yep.
This is, not everything is perfect here.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I like that. So, my love, please, take the floor. What do you got for why you think what Severus Snape does is just?
Okay, Severus Snape believes, with every fiber of his being, that Sirius Black is capable of murder because he tried to do it to him.
Yes.
Okay. He catches Lupin, who was a bestie with Sirius when they grew up, who he warned Dumbledore all this time is not really the best person to be having teach these kids, mm-hmm. and who may be helping Sirius Black. He catches Lupin with Sirius and tries to stop Snape from capturing Sirius.
Yep.
Catches him. And then Lupin turns into a flippin' werewolf and, you know, could potentially be attacking three students. He does turn into a werewolf. Not safe to have on Hogwarts grounds. Mm-hmm. So here's Snape. A murderer gets loose. Dumbledore's like, murderish murderer. Lemon drops, anybody? Like, doesn't care. Fudge is just like trying to rent a dragon. And Snape is sitting here being like, does nobody care? Like, Sirius Black is still missing.
Mm-hmm.
And his bestie is still here at school. When I just saw them last night hanging out together in the Shrieking Shack, oh, and Lupin turns into a werewolf? Nobody's taking this seriously? I'm going to take the situation into my own hands because I know how to do this because I want to protect the kids at Hogwarts and I'm all set with Sirius Black.
Well, Ro here on YouTube says, how do you think Snape rationalizes why Harry would save Sirius if he believes Sirius was still out to get him?
Because he thinks Harry was possibly confounded.
Do you honestly think Snape truly believes Harry was confounded?
I think Snape thinks that Harry is dumb as bricks.
You know what?
You know the kids in kindergarten that you're like, don't eat glue. Don't eat glue.
Yes.
He's like, hey, don't hang out with Lupin. Probably not a good person. Probably don't want to hang out with Sirius Black either. And Harry's like, Expelliarmus, Snape! Eat glue! You know? He's just like, Lily's son is the dumbest kid ever. Like, all I'm trying to do is save him. You know those kids? He's like the kid that you have to put on the baby leash. Like, yes. Kid, why do you keep trying to die?
Don't die.
Please. Stop eating glue, Harry Potter.
Don't eat glue.
Oh, my goodness gracious. We had a question. Can you scroll on up for a hot second? So this, of course, this chapter does reaffirm the fact that at least Snape did not know that Hermione has a time turner. Because pretty much Dumbledore like lays it out like they couldn't be in two places at once, right, guys? So obviously Snape doesn't know. We know McGonagall knows. We know Dumbledore knows. I find it super hard to believe that nobody in the staff is like, Hermione, wait. When do you have Hermione? Like, nobody's talking about brightest kid in the class. The brightest kid in the class gets talked about in teachers' rooms.
I don't know.
This, once again, leads me to believe that the communication between the staff sucks. They don't do trust falls. They don't do bonding activities. They literally teach, maybe have a little bevy together, mm-hmm. and then just hang out in their own rooms. I do not think these people are friends, aside from Hooch and Sprout. Pooch and Sprout, never hear about them in the books because they'd be chilling. They're like, all these people are crazy.
Sprout's got her gin. Pooch has got her bourbon.
Like, let's just go hang out at Hogsmeade. Exams are done. Busting out.
Let's go get twisted.
We know Harry Potter's going to get into something. He gets into something every June.
It's like, ho-hum. Okay,
let's get out of here. Not on my watch. Who wants to have overnight shifts on June 6th? Not it, right?
Death, taxes, and Potter getting in trouble.
Yeah, so it pains me to say this. I may have done what Snape did.
What do you mean?
If I thought I was really right, and if I wanted to save the children of Hogwarts and save glue-eating, baby-leash-wearing Harry Potter, okay, I need to get rid of Lupin! He's a werewolf whose besties with Sirius Black, who's still on the loose. Giddy up, Slytherins. Let's gossip.
I can't
stop. He took a page out of Lady Bridgerton's book.
I can't stop thinking about Harry Potter eating glue.
That's what Snape sits there. He's like, oh my God.
We have everybody here in the chat saying, that's our new shirt, Harry, don't eat glue. You know what, ladies and gents?
I don't know how that'll go over.
That's what we're doing. Just a big picture of Harry eating paste.
No, gross. No, thank you. We will come up with something a bit more creative. But you guys know what I'm saying, right? If you look at it from Snape's perspective, he's like, of course. Of course this kid ends up in the flipping Chamber of Secrets. Who even knew that it was real?
I know. Of course he finds it.
Of course he gets bit by a basilisk. Of course it's him. Yep.
Yep. Freaking James!
Okay, can we take a moment to be with Dumbledore? I know we've hung out with Snape a lot, and I feel like I've gotten a lot of it out. So I feel really, really conflicted, by the way, about my feelings of Snape.
You should.
Really conflicted.
I cannot believe.
How
literally,
can you not believe me?
I literally cannot believe that I'm the one saying Snape did himself.
I would have done
here.
This, and this would have been one of the things that I would have gotten in trouble for. It would have been like the reunion rule that you pull on me.
I always invoke the reunion rule if I have to.
I definitely did. When someone wronged me in college, I went on college TV and set the story straight on college TV.
Oh, yeah. By
the
way,
I was like, just so y'all know.
There's a reward at jointhenerdclan.com for that. So if you want
that, I hate that reward.
It is too bad. Too bad. If you want to go see Mary call one of her fellow classmates out in college, go to jointhenerdclan.com.
Don't say the person's name.
No, you don't.
But he knows who he was.
So
same lies about me leaving my on-call shift. Don't mess with an RA.
Go check out that video at jointhenerdclan.com. It was
just in my room.
A little young Mary when she's like 18 years old.
Oh. Hey guys,
with her Warwick accent.
Who's ever talking about me? Yeah. leaving my dorm when I'm on call.
It's gotta stop.
Okay. Anyway, let's move on from Snape. But as I said, I feel like my blood would have been boiling. I would have leaned into the must do right, must keep people safe, and I would have been able to talk myself into doing something naughty. Mm-hmm. Anyway, Dumbledore.
Dumbledore. What about him? What about him?
So flippin' chill, man.
Very chill. Very like, it's okay, man. Well, because he didn't do nothing. All he did was just say, hey, Harry, go fix it.
What do you mean he didn't do nothing? He did everything.
Well, no, what I'm saying is he was the one who gave him the idea. But Harry did everything. He was just like, okay, be here at, you know, by
ready?
The time.
You ready to do something crazy?
Sure, what do you got?
Okay, you're Dumbledore. Ready?
Yeah,
here
sure.
we are.
Yep.
Hi, Harry and Hermione.
Well, are we doing an early perspective?
No, I'm just like walking it through with you.
Okay, yep.
Hi, Harry and Hermione.
Yeah.
Here's what you got to do. Uh-huh. Bippity boppity boo, Hermione. You know what I mean? Three turns.
Yeah.
Boo. Yeah, sweet. Locking you in. Up. Oh, hey, Harry and Hermione. That worked. Sweet. High five. That's how flipping quick it happened.
That's what I'm saying.
And then he's like, all right, come on in here. Cool. Oh, no. Sirius is gone? What do you mean? Except I just made that plan 5 seconds ago. What?
So this tells me then that, as we discussed last chapter, Dumbledore definitely knew something was up before all this went down.
He knows everything.
And it's such an easy, like, I don't want to say excuse, but it's such an easy thing to say about Dumbledore throughout all of these
His
books.
Mantra is literally Kelly Clarkson. What doesn't kill you makes you stronger. And
yes.
He's trying to get Harry Potter to be like Hulk strong.
Potter smash!
I'm going to literally try to kill you every single which way. Uh-huh. Maybe with 100 Dementors. Maybe with a Basilisk. Who knows? Maybe I'll even dabble you in front of Voldemort.
Yeah. Make you as like, you know.
Let's get you so strong that you're willing to die. It's crazy.
Though, you know what is a little frustrating? Even though
Dumbledore frustrates me a lot. So bring it.
Well, but you know, this doesn't really have necessarily to do with Dumbledore so much as the writing for Dumbledore. The author, I think, at the end of every single book, finally has this moment between Harry and Dumbledore.
It's beautiful.
And it's just like, okay, it's time for the Dumbledore chat. Like,
yeah.
Until
he's dead.
Until he's dead. And
spoiler.
Hashtag spoilers. I get frustrated about the obligatory Dumbledore-Harry conversation.
I think
this is the first time that I do.
Okay, can I say why I don't?
Sure.
Harry doesn't have parents. You know, and this is his time, man. He gets to have this moment with Lupin. He gets to have this moment with Dumbledore. I was actually thinking about it. Like, I would have these moments with my students towards the end of the year. You just do some reflecting time, you know? Leave you with some words of wisdom.
Why the hell did my teachers do any of this?
Probably because you were you.
Yep. Yep. Absolutely. Not going to say no.
What I find just so interesting, though, is how Harry shares Trelawney's prediction with Dumbledore. And he's like, yeah, that sounds like a prediction. Wow, she's finally got two of them. Maybe I should give her a raise. But he just kind of like glosses over it and really instead focuses more on the fact of Harry's mercy for Peter Pettigrew. Glosses over the fact, oh, she made a prediction? Okay, I'm just going to like go upstairs and put that in my pensieve in a moment, but I'm not going to act like it's not a big deal.
Right.
Let's focus more on chilling Harry Potter out, because Harry is having buyer's remorse.
Absolutely. And he's struggling with the idea that he let Scabbers go. It's also slightly manipulative, the way that he rationalizes Harry's decision to himself or to Harry is, well, you know what? Your father probably would have done the same thing, too. So, you know what? Don't worry about that. BT dubs. How about that great Patronus, by the way? Like, let's just whistle past that graveyard of Scabbers. Let's talk about your Patronus and how you conjured up a piece of your dad. Isn't that amazing, Harry? Yay! Like, it's a little manipulative. Just a bit. What are your thoughts on that? I mean, I think the writing of it is, and like the meaning and what it shows for the writing is really beautiful. Like, Harry conjures up a piece of his dad.
Yeah.
Not necessarily his dad, but the part of his dad that lives within him. The part of his dad that he can finally access. Not only now does he have access to his dad through the Marauder's Map, but he has very specific access to his dad right in his heart. And I find that stunning.
You know, what I find stunning right now, for those of you who aren't watching us live, Blake is currently wearing an Avengers shirt.
Yes.
And Thanos is staring at me with his creepy eyes. And I can't help but think, how at moments like this, Kelly, some people wait a lifetime. No?
I got you.
How at a moment like this, Dumbledore reminds me of Thanos.
In what way?
Just like, I know what's best for the world. There's going to be some sacrifices made. There's going to be some sacrifices made that I even love. And I'm not going to necessarily let everybody in on my plan, but I'm going to be super chill about it.
Good one. Okay.
Like, Dumbledore is totally okay with sacrificing people for the greater good.
Oh. Ooh.
Dumbledore.
Not great, Bob.
No, not great, Bob.
Okay, so Angela Hickey says online, I still don't understand why Dumbledore has no concern about this prediction in Pettigrew. After all this, he seems to have a lot of faith in the conscience of the rat dude. So this does come back. The whole Harry has saved Peter Pettigrew's life, and there will be this debt that needs to be paid back. This is like straight up wizard law. This is what...
Yeah,
this is what it is. Like, karma is one thing, but when it comes to wizard karma, you're going to be okay, Harry. So I think it is important for him to say that to Harry and saying, like, it's going to be okay. And I really do think your dad would have done the same thing. So it's not that he's not afraid of Peter. I think he knows that Peter Pettigrew, something will be okay in the end. But I agree with you, Angela. It's like he just takes that prediction that Harry shares with him and puts it in his pocket. And as we delve further into the Harry Potter series, we know that Dumbledore, he spends a lot of time in his office going over all these facts. So when you're reading it now for the first time as the Prisoner of Azkaban, you're like, wow, he just kind of like took that prediction and was like, okay, cool, let's move on. But looking at it now in hindsight, knowing how much Dumbledore mulls over and really studies each of these, what may seem minuscule or big, I mean, having a prediction from Trelawney is pretty big, things, we as readers of this book can really picture him going back upstairs and mulling this over and trying to put the pieces together.
Sure.
But what it comes off as in this book, or what it comes off as to Harry, is, don't worry about that. It's not a big deal. But when you look at it in hindsight, we know that this is a big deal to Dumbledore.
Yeah, Veronica here on Facebook says, but Dumbledore is also okay with sacrificing himself, Mary.
Yes.
So I think that is an important bit to recognize as
well. Yeah, he's not
always out there going, you know, eating some cake and listening to Kelly.
No.
He I think eventually inserts himself into this plan when it becomes necessary.
Yes. Yes. I'm not saying he's like the worst ever.
Worst. He's not the worst burr.
let's do a little quick recap, because I know that we've been like delving into so many different things. Madame Pomfrey, she wishes she could get a night off, except she's the only nurse.
Dude, she needs a night in Mallorca.
She cannot wait
for school
to be done.
You know, she's just got a case of vodka.
Dumbledore came up to her and was like, hey, you know, I was thinking we could do like a Hogwarts summer school, you know, like summer camp. No.
She's gonna blow off the staff party and everything. She's gonna be goodbye.
Gone.
Goodbye, I'm out.
Bye.
See you later.
Peace out, Cub Scout. So we have Madame Pomfrey doing as much as she can, totally oblivious to everything that's going on. We've got Fudge, who, as I said, he's going to flip-flop all over the place with his beliefs and his feelings on things. We get this lovely note that comes on the Hogwarts Express as Harry, Ron, and Hermione are traveling back home to London, and this wee little owl comes on up with this note from Sirius saying, don't worry, man, I made it safe, we're okay. We'll stay in touch. P.S. Here's my notes. You can always go to Hogsmeade. You're welcome. And here's a little owl for Ron since I got rid of his pet.
So I think once again, kind of leaning into the idea of justice, Sirius is the one who finally replaces the missing pet because he was the one who did it to Ron. So There is an ongoing push and pull of what is just and what is unjust and how those just things are served to the rest of our story. It's simple and it's easy and it's nice. It's a great gesture, I think, for the writing. One of the things I always love to do too, Mary, is compare where, you know, our characters begin to where they end. I mean, this is the end of the book. We have finished The Prisoner of Azkaban.
I mean, it's funny because the first chapter, isn't it Owl Post?
I think so.
Yeah. So our first chapter is Owlpost. Our last chapter is Owlpost again.
Yes, right.
You know, we go on this circle. We get...
Bookends. That's a Merry and Blake commandment.
We get Lupin giving the Marauder's Map to Harry along with his invisibility cloak. Right. And even saying, like, yeah, I think your dad would want you to have this. I think he kind of would want you to find all these little secret tunnels when he had taken them away before. And he, in fact, is one of the Marauders that he's giving it to him. So I think it's pretty cool.
Right. And the way that Harry begins this book, if you remember, he is alone. And when he leaves the Dursleys' house, he is very alone, has no contact with his friends, has no contact with the wizarding world. He has left the Dursleys' residence. He is literally by himself, just waiting. And then he gets the night bus, and the night bus comes and rescues him, and then we have the beginning of the story. At the end of this chapter, we have Harry, who not only has a connection to Sirius because he is his godfather, but Harry now has a connection to something that he has always been wanting, a real legitimate connection to his father. Something that he has been lacking this entire time. A real, genuine piece of his father he actually has. So he is no longer alone. And the beginning of the first book was finding a home, finding a place to exist. The second book ended with, I'm no longer alone. I actually have real connections. I have real family. I have friends. I have people that love me. This one is finding, the end of this book is finding a connection to his past. And these serve as connections to his past. It's really nice. Really quite nice.
I love it.
Great bookends. I'll say that.
Truly, truly. Well, before we get into the different perspective, we wanted to remind you that the sponsor for the Potterverse is actually MinuteWithMary.com. In addition to podcasting, I love to help people feel more creative with their makeup and just more confident with their skincare. I would love for you, if you're on Facebook, to search the hashtag MinuteWithMary and request to join my VIP group. I share loads of free tips and tricks in there, and I really do strive to help you feel really confident with whatever it is you're doing with your face. So hashtag Minute with Mary. Now it's time for the different perspective.
Let's do it.
Holy cricket, you're Harry Potter. I'm Hermione Granger. And you are?
I mean, I gotta be Crookshanks.
Crookie!
Hey!
Crookie's back!
Harry Potter and Crookshanks.
Hey, Crookie, what's going on?
You know, this has been such a good year.
Yeah?
I love life.
Okay, why do you love life, Crookie?
I got a human.
Oh, yeah, okay,
she's
sure.
Awesome. She's so awesome.
A little bit of a nerd.
No, I dig it, man. Love it. And totally caught a murderer. What's up?
Hi-oh.
You know that, like, How to Make a Murderer on Netflix?
Yeah, yeah, I've seen
how
that.
How to Catch a Murderer by Crookshanks. It's crazy. And then this kid, Ron, who, like, hates me.
You know, I always felt that was a little unjust, Crookie. You know, you're doing your best you can to actually, to, like, be cool with Harry, save, like, Hogwarts and stuff.
Yep.
And he's just sitting there busting on you the entire time.
He didn't know.
Yeah.
You know?
Yep, yep.
I mean, he's a kid. He's just a kid.
He just doesn't know any better.
He's not like a bad kid.
You're a Kneasel.
Oh, my gosh. And pot. Pot, man.
But, yeah.
Only pot. Okay? Let's get the story straight. But I'm really pumped because now Ron, he loves me.
Uh-huh.
He loves me. And he got a new pet.
Yeah, what's that new pet like?
Pigwidgeon. We don't know his name yet, but it's going to be Pigwidgeon.
Oh, you know this net by now?
I mean, I'm a Kneasel.
Yeah.
Pot.
Pot Kneasel.
The key is silent. You're welcome. The end.
When Crookie comes out, man, Crookie's the best. Crookie.
I felt like I had to end it. And you know, this is Crookshank's last big moment.
That's true. It's worth bringing Crookie voice out. I think we have to have a replay of Crookie voice.
Just throughout.
Every once in a while. Just to give...
Hey, when he makes an appearance,
you know,
he'll make an appearance
with
us.
It's like the Greek chorus, but in this case, it's just the Crookie chorus.
Love it. Love it. Well, before we get into our emails and questions, friends who are joining us live, please re-administer your questions with a lightning bolt preceding the question.
Re-administer?
I don't know. I'm just trying to be fancy, I guess.
Look
I don't know.
You.
Sometimes
yeah,
this
yeah,
happens.
SAT words.
Hey, you know. That's how I roll. But before we do this, I do want to remind you all listening and joining in live that we actually have a complimentary texting reminder service. In case you wanted to join us live on Facebook, YouTube, or Instagram, all you need to do is in the U.S., text the phone number 81010, and in the message field, mm-hmm. the at symbol Elderwand, all together, no spaces, at symbol Elderwand, mm-hmm. at Elderwand. And what's going to happen is me, yep, me, this little girl that you can like hear in your voice, I'm not really little, I'm actually quite tall, I will send you a text being like, guess what, we're going to be going live today. You do not want to miss out on this. So make sure you sign up. And if you're out of the country, out of the U.S., you can go to remind.com/join/Elderwand. Now, let's get into our emails.
Of course, as if you are listening to us on the podcast app, you are not alone. You are not alone. You can send us an email and we will read your emails on,
so out of sync, that's okay.
on the show when we receive them. Just email us at maryandblakemedia@gmail.com. And for those of you who are watching us live right now on all the various social media platforms, Mary, what are they supposed to do?
I already said it. Put a lightning bolt.
All right. Good. Just making sure.
Hey, when the hosts are not listening.
How to tell when the hosts aren't listening.
All right, let's do listener questions.
Oh, Miles here.
All right, the first one comes from Lacey. Actually, Lacey and Alexis. Alexis is new to the Potterverse, so Alexis...
Welcome.
Welcome. Here we go. Well, I got to play the sound for you. Thank you so much, Alexis. All right, the first one she asks is, one, why do some people put Narcissa on a pedestal for risking her life for Draco, which means lying, but dismiss Lily's sacrifice as something any mother ought to do?
Read it one more time to me so I can fully understand.
Why do some...
Hold on. Oh, what? I'm listening.
How to tell when the hosts aren't listening.
Why do some people put Narcissa on a pedestal for risking her life for Draco when she lies, but dismisses Lily's sacrifice as something any mother ought to do? I don't feel like anybody dismisses it.
Who are these peeps?
The secret
who be dismissing
they,
my Lily?
The all-encompassing they.
Well, they need to quiet themselves.
I don't think they dismiss.
I mean, Blake and I really don't get out much anymore, so we don't really talk to many days. But Blake and I think that Lily gets major props.
I think so. I've never... In fact, I think that from my experience, nobody has spoken about Lily except in glowing terms.
If anyone speaks ill of her.
Oh, nobody should speak ill of her.
They're going to have some Snape wrath.
Oh, you don't mess with... He freaks out. He starts spluttering and freaking. Gets all
high pitched. You. Watch out.
I know you did it! All right, number two. What if they called it Potter's Army and not Dumbledore's Army?
I don't think Harry would have gone with that.
I don't think Harry
would have felt like, please don't put any more spotlight on me than it already is.
Yeah, and it was really about Dumbledore. It was really about upholding what Dumbledore stood for in Book 5 as opposed to what Harry stood for. Mm-hmm. Why does Snape hate Harry? Since he loved Lily and Harry is a product of her, then shouldn't it be the opposite, Mary?
No. He looks just like James, yes. And he's as arrogant.
Well, at least he interprets Harry to be as,
Snape
as arrogant.
As yes. arrogant. And he thinks he eats glue. Just stay put. Why can't you be more like Neville? Just stay put.
I forgot about the glue joke. So I'm like, wait, Harry what? Harry eats glue? And I was like, oh, yeah, okay, I got it. All right, number four, why didn't Bellatrix kill Harry instead of Sirius? Hashtag spoilers. She killed Sirius when he wasn't seen by them after Sirius defeated Lucius. She had time to kill Harry instead of Sirius. Voldemort's point was to kill Harry. Why didn't she just do in Harry?
I mean, I would have, I don't know. That's a good question. We'll get to their when we're in the book.
I think they're cousins and they clearly have an antagonistic relationship. Yeah. And to me, Voldemort wanted Harry Potter. And for Bellatrix to go ahead and do in Harry as opposed to Voldemort doing it, that would be a big problem. And I think she's well aware of that. And having said that, killing Sirius, to me, is much more antagonistic than killing Harry. Number one, because if she does it, the books are over, right? So you can't have that. But number two...
Harry Potter and dead.
Yeah, Harry Potter, yeah, and the dead guy. But it's much more awful, and it's much more torturing, and it's much more antagonistic that she kills...
Is she supposed to kill Harry, though? This is hard.
No, I don't think so.
I don't think so either. I don't think Voldemort would want her to be killing Harry.
All right.
But this is like forward thinking, sorry.
And then lastly, number five, what if Lily Potter did not have a sister who would look after Harry? What would happen to Harry? What do you think would happen to Harry? I think this might be when your absolute favorite fanfic comes into the picture.
Oh, Minerva McGonagall would have adopted him.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Absolutely. This one comes from Kim. She says, the way I interpreted the sneakoscope going off wasn't because of Crookshanks, but because of Peter Pettigrew. Ron's rat was also around every time the sneakoscope went off, and Ron said it kept going off the whole time when he was on vacation with his family in Egypt. That's why Ron said he thought it was broken.
Yes.
Yes, totally agree. The book, I think... pushes you to think that it's Crookshanks, but we eventually recognize that it's not Crookshanks, it's actually Peter Pettigrew, and that's the reason why it's freaking out. All right, let's see what we got here for the questions here on our live. Angela says, I still understand why Dumbledore has no concern about this prediction and Pettigrew. After all of this, he seems to have a lot of faith in the conscience of a rat.
We covered this question.
Okay. Then she says, hasn't the Ron and his family been protecting Harry and saving him all along? I think Pettigrew likely has a lot of debt, if that is the standard.
Yes.
Yes, I would.
I will say that. Yes.
Ro says, what did happen to Crookshanks after this book and series?
Okay, so after this book, Crookshanks is still with Hermione.
Yes.
He is still Hermione's pet. We're going to see him from time to time. He gets pretty close with Ginny, and he's with Hermione when she goes and visits the Burrow. I do believe he's just left at the Burrow at the end of the series when Hermione, Ron, and Harry need to go on a wee bit of a travel.
Yes.
They don't
go camping.
You can't camp with a cat, okay? So I'm pretty sure Crookshank stays home at the Burrow.
I could do things. I could cook hot dogs.
Probably good.
Rachel says, would you consider doing an episode of the Potterverse on stuff Dumbledore knows and or set up?
Ooh, you know, I think this would need to be like towards the end of the book series, but that would be an extraordinarily fun episode.
We will revisit that.
Yes. And Rachel, if you will remind us.
Yes.
That would be awesome sauce.
Caitlin asks, how soon do you think Lupin told the Weasley parents about Sirius? Can you imagine Ron telling them that he got his new owl from Sirius Black when they still think he is a murderer? Here's a question. Do they think he's a murderer? Because if Harry says, no, dude, he ain't a murderer, I think they're going to believe him.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because eventually they do the whole Order of the Phoenix and Sirius is there and so on and so forth. But, you know, is there that split of time where they think Sirius is out and he's actually going after Harry?
Okay, you know what I think?
What?
I don't even think Mr. and Mrs. Weasley noticed that Ron has a pet. I think they have so many kids and so many animals.
That's true.
It's
good
just
point.
Like, they don't even know. They don't even know.
You know, they were trying to go on vacation like the last time and they were just like, get me out of this house with all of these kids.
No, but I think they will believe. They will believe Harry. They probably wouldn't believe Ron, but they'll believe Harry.
Yeah. So, they definitely would not believe Ron. You know, it's
might.
No, it's kind of like you. You don't listen to anything I say until somebody else says it and then you listen. Don't tell me that doesn't happen, because it does.
Nope.
Okay, fine. That feels like it.
That feels like it too. All right. Like, yay. All right. You want to wrap things up?
Yeah. So this is the end. This is the end of the Harry Potter and the Prisoner of Azkaban.
What's up next, Blake?
What's up next? Mary and I will be doing a live commentary track for Harry Potter and the Prisoner of Azkaban film. that will be located at only jointhenerdclan.com. It's only for the members at jointhenerdclan.com. So you nerds get that. So if you want to hear our live commentary for this
meaning
film,
you could like press play when we press play, and it's yes. like we're sitting next to you because we'll be commenting while we watch the movie.
Yes.
And we can watch it together.
And if you want to listen to the one for The Prisoner of Azkaban or the previous two films, just go to jointhenerdclan.com and they are all there. And we will be doing this for each successive film afterwards too. So you don't want to miss out on that. And then, of course, after that, we will be doing this style podcast, a free podcast, just for the Potterverse, talking and breaking down the film, not as a commentary track, but just like how we do here, you know, just talking about it back and forth, arcs and characters and cinematography and direction and writing and all the good stuff that happens there. So that is that. That's the upcoming schedule. And then right after that, next week will be our film review week. Yes, okay.
And then the week after that, we're starting the Goblet of Fire.
Yeah, we're jumping
I'm
right
so
in.
I'm so excited.
We're jumping right into the Goblet of Fire, and I got to tell you, not looking forward to it.
And Rachel clarifies, nobody finds out about Sirius Black until the end of Goblet Fire at the end.
Okay, yep. Tammy asks...
They're too excited for the Quidditch World Cup.
Tammy asks, is the movie going to be a watch-along? I mean, in theory, yes.
It's an audio?
Yeah.
So you won't actually be watching physically along with
like,
us.
Like, we're not going to be streaming it all together.
This won't be a streamed thing.
Right. It will be... Mary and I are going to watch it in the comfort of our own home. We will be recording the audio track of our commentary along with the film, and then we'll tell you, okay, all right, hit press play now, and then you can press play and at a later time, and you can listen to us at your leisure. So it won't be a live thing for the members there, just a pre-recorded deal, if you will. Got anything else to say about this, Marvin?
That is
or
it.
Nothing else?
No, nothing. That's
it. Okay, let's close it out. Shall we get a surprise for you?
Oh, exciting.
What if I told you it was all meant to be?
Oh.
Would you believe?
Oh, yeah.
Would you believe?
This is vintage.
It's almost that feeling.
This is a song that I had to prance
so
around to during my pageant days.
I'm
trying to think which pageant it was. I did it several years. I actually made a lot of money.
Highlights in there.
Oh man. Classic of those days. What year did this come out? Was it 2000?
This is 20. Well, the video here that I have was posted in 2011.
No.
But I feel like this is much earlier than that.
I definitely pranced around to this song at some point in my gown. this was, you know, like in pageants when it's like the ladies prance around their gowns. Part.
Yes.
It's supposed to be like to show your grace and your elegance, and basically you don't move your upper body at all, and you have this plastic smile, and you just like magically move like you're on a hoverboard.
Yeah.
This is the song I had to do that to.
Oh, yeah. I could feel that. Oh, all right. So, everybody, thank you so much for listening to the Potterverse tonight and joining us live as we are here. If you want to go to maryandblake.com, check out all the great podcasts that we have over there, whether it is Outlander Cast or it is Bridgerton with Mary and Blake. We got a whole ton of stuff, including the fact that it's the MCU Diaries. I just wrapped up the finale for The Falcon and the Winter Soldier for the MCU Diaries, and I will say, not impressed. Impressed with the finale.
Oh.
Not impressed. Like, I was going to say, Mary, we should be watching this, but like, I kind of don't want to have you watch it.
Good.
Like,
that was easy.
It's just one less thing.
I'll watch Loki. I like Loki. Loki's more my style.
I am all about the Loki life.
So we cover a lot of things. You can check it all out at maryandblake.com. Don't forget, this podcast has been sponsored by #MinuteWithMary.
Yes.
And those of you at jointhenerdclan.com, keep your eyes peeled for our live recording of our reactions to the Prisoner of Azkaban film. Whew. This is going to be like a big talk when we do it, because the book and the film, very, very different.
Very different. But in good ways. Both good ways. Oh, oh, it's like we're married.
Oh, gosh. Yes. All right. On that note, guys, we got to go because Blake and I are starting to become one mind. It's pretty creepy.
All right.
My name's Neri.
My name is Blake.
Mischief managed. Sirius on the back of Buckbeak with his arms. For a
moment. Oh, that's good stuff.
You're welcome.
That is good stuff.
He'd sit there being like, you know, Dumbledore's got good taste in music.
Ladies and gents, this is why you listen all the way to the end of the podcast.
That's right.